A man squatted 500 pounds after chugging 3 energy drinks. This is what happened to his legs. LF is a 28-year-old man presenting to the emergency room with numbness in his right leg. The medical team takes a full body scan, and when they look at the image, it tells them that LF might not have much time left. They need to move him to another hospital that can take better care of him. LF was a nurse working in the hospital. During the events of 2020, while taking care of the sudden influx of patients, he developed a caffeine habit. At first, it was just coffee in the morning, but very quickly, it became a whole pot of coffee. Then he added energy drinks before moving on to pure caffeine. One morning at 5 a.m., LF was going to the gym. He downed some energy drinks to prepare himself. It was time to lift heavy. While he was warming up, everything felt good. He loaded up the bar, walked out the rack with 500 pounds on his back, and he could feel the weight push him down into the ground. After coming up with it, his vision turned dark. He racked the weight, and he could tell that the blood vessels in his face had popped, but then he laid down to do some crunches. Suddenly, a pain pierced through his chest. He felt like someone had plunged a sharp object into his heart. A burning started radiating to his neck. His fingers started tingling. Walking around in a world of hurt, LF thought that maybe he had just been laying down in the wrong position. But as the minutes passed, the feeling only got worse. Drawing upon his medical training, LF suspected that he might be having a heart attack. Heart attacks are when the heart starves of oxygen. This typically happens because of a blockage. The heart is metabolically active, so it needs a lot of oxygen to produce energy to function. When a heart attack happens, it's often because a blood clot is in the blood vessel supplying blood to the heart. A medicine that can quickly start to work on this blood clot is aspirin, which is almost always given to patients with a suspected heart attack. LF had cared for these patients in the past, and knowing that this could be happening to him now, he immediately tells his coach to give him 4 aspirin tablets to chew so that the medicine can quickly absorb into his body as paramedics arrive. But it didn't seem like anything was wrong. LF's heart rhythm was normal. No signs of a heart attack. His blood pressure and his heart rate were fine. Because he was only 28 years old and was previously healthy, it really didn't seem like anything was wrong. LF was still standing. He was responsive and oriented. This means that his brain was fine. Paramedics told him to sit down and take a deep breath, and he should be okay. They convinced him that he probably didn't need to go to the emergency room as they leave the gym. But as the hour passed, LF still had this pain in his chest. At home now, he laid down on his bed because he thought he could sleep this off. A tingling in his fingers and his right leg became more and more intense, and his mind was racing, unsure of what was really happening. In the bathroom, nauseous, LF goes to empty his stomach into the toilet, but then suddenly his right leg becomes numb. He collapses to the ground. 911 is called, and LF is brought to the emergency room where we are now. At examination, the medical team instantly notices that LF's right leg is a different color than his left, and that it's cold to the touch. Instead of a blood clot in his heart, it could be a huge clot clogging his leg, starving it of oxygen, causing it to become a different color, and to become cold. LF was sent in for a full-body CT scan, and when the images returned, the medical team couldn't believe what they saw. When someone experienced lifts really heavy weights for compound movements like squat, bench press, or deadlift, they often perform the Valsalva maneuver. That is, they breathe in and hold their breath through almost the entire movement. The reason that this is done is because when the lift is performed, it's ideal to keep every single part of the body as tight as possible because anything loose can become a point of failure. You have to do this when you're lifting very heavy. And the weights that I'm talking about are ones that are so heavy that when you're under the bar, you have thoughts that linger in the back of your mind that you're not going to make it. I'm not talking about something like squatting body weight on the bar, but rather 3, 4, or 5 times of body weight. The problem is, when the breath is held in like that, during that stress, it causes blood pressure inside the body to skyrocket. And you can see it happen in real time because powerlifters will have blood vessels pop right out of their neck. The body is a closed and self-contained system, but the sudden massive increase in pressure can test the flexibility of the blood vessels. The heart starts to beat very hard and very fast against this pressure, causing blood flow to become chaotic and turbulent. It's well documented that this setting increases shear stress against the walls of the arteries. in the overwhelming majority of the time, for people who are healthy with no prior health problems, the body can handle this. In fact, when you're lifting this heavy, if you don't do this in some capacity, you can severely injure yourself. But in the setting of an accident, something else can happen. And in LF, there was an accident. The CT scan images showed that LF was experiencing an aortic dissection. Aortic, referring to the aorta, the largest artery that comes out of the heart, sending oxygenated blood all throughout the body, and dissection, referring to a cutting open of. LF's aorta had ripped open from the inside close to where it connected to his heart, but this rip was contained to the inner linings of the aorta. This explains his sudden chest pain radiating to his neck, but what was happening to his right leg? Immediately, when seeing this, the medical team knew that they had to send LF to a larger hospital that could take better care of him. An ambulance was called. On the ride over, LF called his mom. He gave her bank passwords, social media logins, and advanced directives on what to do, because as someone who was medically trained, he knew what was happening to him. He knew that he might have waited too long that morning to get medical care, and he knew there's a chance that he's not going to come back from this. The ambulance arrived at the larger hospital as the last thing he could remember. Surgeons quickly took a look at LF. Blood vessels are made of different layers. The inside layer is called the intima. Typically, when blood flows through, it kind of rolls along this inside layer through the whole of the vessel called the lumen. When a tear evolves from the intima, blood flow still rolls along that inner layer, but blood is a fluid. If it can flow into something, it will. LF's tear started from where the aorta emerges from the heart. Blood started seeping into the tear, pushing apart the layers of the aorta, creating a false lumen. Blood stuck in here doesn't travel through the body, rather, it continues down the aorta, separating the layers before eventually emerging through the aorta again, further down, by creating another tear. Surgeons repair the area where his tear originated. This should fix most of his problems, and it seemed like he was doing well. But very quickly, the medical team finds that it wasn't enough. The legs make up a high percentage of muscle in the body, but when we look at how blood is circulated from the heart, it's almost like nature is telling us its priorities. When blood is pumped, some of it goes right back to the heart muscle. Then it goes towards the brain, the arms, the organs, and only after all of that does it keep traveling to the legs. But because the legs are so muscular, it means that they need a lot of blood to function. But fixing the origin of LF's aortic dissection didn't fix the blood flow blockage in his right leg. The muscle starts to starve of oxygen, and it can't survive anymore. Muscles are covered by a layer of tissue called the fascia. As LF's muscle wastes away inside, the leg starts to swell. The swelling chokes out the blood vessels, supplying blood to the leg and squashes the nerves, and the fascia doesn't budge. If left untreated, his right leg will need to be amputated. They send him in for surgery to make some incisions and relieve the pressure, but just doing this won't fix why his right leg wasn't getting enough blood in the first place. So, what was happening? This brings us back to false lumen. The blood flow through this evolving tear is inconsistent because it's not supposed to exist. Even though the origin of LF's aortic tear was repaired, for some reason, blood in the false lumen had started to pool, causing that blood to clot, becoming like a jelly. The swelling is so great that it collapsed the true lumen of the blood vessel, stopping blood flow to the leg. This is called thrombosis. Throm meaning lump, but referring to blood clot, and osis meaning a disorder of. A disorder because of a blood clot inside the false lumen. In order to quickly get blood flowing again to his right leg, surgeons go below the clot and use a tube to connect it with the artery supplying blood to his left leg. This is a temporary fix while they decide how to proceed. When surgeons cut into his fascia to prevent pressure from building up in his right leg, damaged muscle waste quickly spilled out and started to float around in his body. Surgeons had gotten in just at the right time because parts of LF's leg had already died. The kidneys are kind of like a net that filter the blood, but as LF's damaged muscle started collecting in his kidneys, it started destroying them, blocking flow, and preventing him from making any urine. As the days pass, the medical team has to irrigate and drain LF's abdomen with fluid to try to catch wastes that should be caught by his kidneys. He's intermittently placed on dialysis, a machine that filters his blood for him, but very quickly, the tube that was connecting his left leg's blood supply to his right leg became infected. hospital bacteria started growing and spreading in LF's body, causing his heartbeat and heart rhythm to become erratic. This isn't too abnormal when one receives this kind of surgery, but LF had taken care of patients with exactly the same problem as he's having now. His heartbeat was so uncomfortable, and he was so scared that if he were to fall asleep by accident, that he wasn't going to wake up. But why did the aortic dissection happen in the first place? Well, let's look at where the tear happened at the aortic arch. Do you remember turbulent flow? Well, when fluid flows through a bend, the sudden change in direction tends to increase the amount of stress in the system. This stress has been shown to cause changes to the inner lining of blood vessels. A lot of methods used to classify aortic dissections come from different locations in the aortic arch. LF was a previously healthy 28-year-old man with no known health problems, but he did have multiple risk factors. Heavy weightlifting features way more than just the Valsalva maneuver. Aortic dissections have been described in people who lifted just an 80-pound dumbbell. There might have been a positional component to this, that he was bent over in an awkward position or he kicked the dumbbell back to lay down on the bench to do his set. But there's also the component of LF taking excessive amounts of caffeine and energy drinks that would have compounded with this heavy lifting. Let's start with caffeine. It's a stimulant, but it does that stimulating by blocking inhibition. In regular doses, like 400 milligrams or less daily, it means that you feel a bit more awake and alert and maybe more productive. But at excessive doses all the time, rather than blocking inhibition, caffeine gets the body to release adrenaline, which is going to raise blood pressure. When you drink caffeine, it takes usually 4 to 6 hours for its level in your body to cut in half. That is, it takes around 4 to 6 hours for your body to break down the caffeine. If you take a lot of it and it increases your blood pressure for hours every day, and remember, most people continuously consume more caffeine throughout the day, then you could reasonably expect that you could be chronically increasing the amount of stress on the intima throughout the aortic arch. That's a potential risk factor, but it might not have been the only thing happening in LF. Lots of pre-workout supplements also feature a lot of caffeine. Sometimes it's really the only actual thing that they have. And sometimes people take multiple supplements that all have caffeine, and it's all going to add up to much more than 400 milligrams daily. So their blood pressure is high just from supplements. Add in energy drinks, add in more caffeine throughout the day, then add in really heavy lifting. Add in that LF went to lift heavy on a winter morning, a season and a time when aortic dissections appear to be more likely to happen. And all of these risks can add up. And blood vessels are muscles. That means that the aorta has its own set of blood vessels that supply its blood, independent of the blood that it's delivering to the rest of the body. This is called the vasa vasorum. It's possible that LF's aortic dissection wasn't just a consequence of turbulent flow causing heavy stress on the intima, but that other ingredients in his energy drinks or supplements had also affected the integrity of his small blood vessels. We're never gonna really know for sure in his particular case, but this has been described in literature. We know that supplements contain multiple ingredients in unknown concentrations because there's a proprietary blend, and nothing in this space is required to be standardized, so every batch might be different. But we know many people simply consume way too much caffeine, often without realizing that it's coming from many different sources throughout the day. Sometimes from bread, restaurant, lemonade. There's other complex situations too, such as if LF was taking medicines for prior health problems, including ones for mental health. Those can increase blood pressure, but he wasn't taking those, and neither was he taking performance-enhancing substances. LF was medically trained. Being able to have a career and to pay his bills and to make a living depended on him having and maintaining his healthcare licensure. Even just having performance-enhancing substances in your possession can get your license yanked because many of them are controlled substances. And the overwhelming majority of reasonable people would rather be able to have a career, be able to pay their rent and their bills for the next several years than to be able to lift a heavier weight. Can performance-enhancing substances increase the risk of aortic dissection in the setting? It looks like they might be able to. In the intensive care unit, LF's surgeon decides on a treatment plan. They'll get access to his aorta through his back while he's laid on his side. They'll make a cut along his aorta where the blood clot is and take it out. Then they'll remove the part of the inner lining of his aorta that was separated out and pin down the remaining portion, closing the aorta up to allow blood flow through to his right leg again. Valsalva maneuver in very heavy lifting is necessary to keep everything in your body tight throughout the whole movement to prevent injury. What happened to LF was more than just Valsalva. It was additional multiple risk factors, and most importantly, it was an accident. I lived a very similar arrangement for many years. I didn't lift in the mornings, but this could have been me. As days become weeks in the hospital, LF's condition appears to improve. Nothing needed to be amputated. At physical therapy months later, he was able to first stand up and then walk again, and he was able to make a recovery.
Hey everybody, my name is Luis Torres and I'm the real patient LF. Right now, I can still go to the gym, I can still work out. I can't lift more than 35 pounds. I drive with my left foot and I can still do patient care. Life still goes on and I gotta just adapt with what I can and can't do. One thing that I would have done differently that day when I initially presented with those symptoms is that I would have went to the hospital right away. That way I would have not sustained the deficits that I've sustained right now. However, God works in mysterious ways. I'm just glad that I went back and called that second ambulance. If you're at home or you're doing something and you're starting to feel something that's not right, please get checked out immediately. I would have never thought at the age of 28 I would go through such a medical emergency to the point where in an ambulance I had to call my mother and tell her what my wishes would be. There's always a saying that in the medical field that one day we'll all become patients. And now that I have the perspective of both being the patient and the provider, that gives me an edge to be more and more of a compassionate provider. My goal now is to get my doctor to nurse practitioner, and I've just been accepted into Rush's doctor program. And so that's something that I have looking forward to. My program starts in the fall.
Best of luck in your studies, Luis. Thank you so much for watching. Be sure to check out Copilot, link in the description, or this QR code. Take care of yourself and be well.